So you like that one. That's okay.
And the litmus test.
We've got Corey Hart with us tonight. We're just going through a kind of a retrospective of his work here, getting the views. Now, Sunglasses Night is I mean, that's almost a signature song.
It was my first single. It was what introduced the world to my music. And I was really fortunate that it came out at the right time. And a lot in this business has to do with timing.
Yeah. And so why did it work?
Well, I think, you know, we talk about bottling something. I think that would be a pretty good one to bottle if you knew what works. I just think it was a combination of a lot of elements, but it just was right for the time, and it was the right image, the right song, and the right record company behind
it. How did you cope with that, with being everybody's dream? I mean, the women at the foot of the
nightmare.
Stage. Come on. Was it really?
No, I didn't mean it was a nightmare.
No,
I mean,
you were everybody's dream. I mean, so young, such fame. I mean, everywhere you went, mobbed.
Well, you know, you basically, you learn on the job how to deal with that. And I never really subscribed to the mythology of what the rock star was and what you read about. And in fact, I wrote a song about that on my fourth record. Actually, my fifth album called Icon, which is a really self-deprecating look at how absurd, you know, being a rock star really is. Mm-hmm. And of course it was flattering, and of course I tended to become a little more isolated, and I'm a private person to begin with, so it just pushed on that's
trigger. Your response to it. You pull back, you don't say, oh gee, I am sliced bread here.
No, well, you could, but I didn't. I definitely didn't do that.
And what allowed you not to be able to do that? Because so many people are, you know, find that so seductive and can't say no.
I really don't know. A lot of people have asked me that, and I don't have the, I can't put my finger on it. I think it's because, you know, maybe the way my mom raised me.
Yeah, I was going to say, I mean, this must be some way, something far back.
I don't really know, except that what I do is, I'm very fortunate to be able to. Not many people are as privileged in their careers to do something that they love, genuinely love to do. So I consider it a real gift to be able to do music and have people respond to it, and I value that every day. Every night I go out and play a concert. Every time I go into the studio, I value it, and I just try not to buy into the mythology.
Your older sister at one point introduced you to Paul Anka when you were quite young.
I was 11.
And were you really able to learn from him at that age?
Well, what happened was is that it influenced me to go to the piano because he was a piano player. Had he played guitar, I probably would have went to the guitar. I didn't understand about songwriting because I was just singing at the time at 11 and 12. And because he played piano, I thought, well, that's the instrument I should play. And then I developed an interest in Billy Joel's early work, and I stayed on the piano, and it became my instrument. But did I learn anything? Only so much an 11-year-old can learn.
Right. So it wasn't there that you kind of got, or maybe it's in part because of the early age, that somehow you have this in perspective.
Perhaps. I mean, there's a lot of artists that start very early on, and they veer off because it comes and it goes. And I always, I'm not saying that there was a period of time where my records weren't selling as well.
Yeah. And was that hard too?
Well, of course.
Yeah. I mean, you take that personally.
Absolutely. I think any artist that will tell you that they don't care are not being honest, because you create to touch people. Mm-hmm. And if, you know, it's all on a scale, a barometer. I mean, what is success? Is it 10 million records or is it a million records? I mean, the numbers are all confusing after a while, but you get a feeling when you know a record's reached people and has touched people. And a few of my records came and went very quickly. And of course, you feel a sense of loss, and you feel a
disappointment. Is that part of the reason you ended up with, as you put it, with nothing to say? I mean, if you put out a couple of albums in a row, and the public says, I don't like that, then you start to really question yourself?
It may have played into it. I really believe that I wrote very, I was very prolific through my 20s. I recorded 6 albums in a period of 8 years. And I really believe that it was inevitable that I would reach a point where I just wouldn't have any more songs to write. And I probably could have taken outside songs, which is something the record companies have always wanted me to do, and work with hit writers from the States.
I was quite astounded by that. I mean, you said no to actually performing the music for Top Gun and Beverly Hills Cop. I mean, these are two mega blockbusters. You would have made a ton of money.
Yeah, but it's never been about the money. So I agree that they probably weren't smart career moves. Whoever said that.
In retrospect.
But I would make the same decisions today because it's... I know I don't want to record anyone's material. It's not my own unless it's a real classic chestnut or something.
Yeah, now on this one is Love Hurts, which I immediately said Graham Parsons, Emmylou Harris. You said no, originally the Everly Brothers. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I love that song. What's the appeal to you?
Well, I'd only done one other cover in my career. On my third album, I did Elvis's Can't Help Falling in Love, which some people... loved and some hated.
Oh, no, it was wonderful.
Well, when I went down south, I was on tour in America, and a lot of the southern states were pretty angry that I had the nerve, you know, sacrilegious to take the king's work on. But the song did quite well, and a lot of people seemed to like it. So you asked me about Love Hurts. It was a suggestion from the record company, from actually the man that signed me to Columbia, Vito Loprano, and he...
And it fits your mood? I mean, you have to look at the lyrics. I mean, this is not a happy song.
Right. Yeah, it's... well, no, it's not a happy song. It seemed to work in the tapestry of all the other songs on the album, and I kept an open mind to it, and I said, I'll record it, and at the end of the day, we'll listen to the whole album and see if it fits. And it seemed to work.
We're going to take a listen to some more work by Corey Hart, the old stuff. I get to sit here in the studio and watch his reactions to it. I'll tell you right after this break.